Good morning and welcome to church this morning. I think we still know how to do this. We're really thankful for the chance to be up here and singing again with you. I hope you are too. You can stand with us as we sing. This music so you can actually read it while Wade comes up to do announcements.
Good morning. How's everyone today? Fantastic, because we're here, right? Announcement time. I don't have any announcements though, so. Anyone else have anything to say? Announcements? Gord.
Yeah. We're trying to put together a Bible study for Saturday night. Won't know until next Thursday if it's okay or not.
Yeah.
But here at the church, 6 o'clock will be supper, probably. But make sure you confirm before you show up.
Yep, Gord's working on Bible study, so.
I'm not ahead of it. We're just having a Bible study and some dinner, and we're going to read the Bible and sing with you. Saturday night starts at 6 if you want dinner, 7 o'clock for study.
Sounds like a good time. Go ahead, Becky.
We're going to leave the prayer sister chart back there, or list, if you need a prayer partner. I'm going to leave that there probably another week or two and see who would like to be on there. And usually those are prayer sisters. I had somebody visiting with me this morning. Gord's put his name back there. I don't know, sometimes whenever we put those together, we just put all the names in the hat and pull them out. And Gord's wanting a prayer partner.
No, I've got one.
Oh, you already have one?
Yes, but I don't know her name.
Well, we don't usually pick them. I mean, we usually sometimes put them in the hat and pull them out, and I'm not sure how we should do that.
I confused you. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah, I get confused.
We're good.
That's okay, yeah. So anyway, everybody, if you would like to have a prayer partner, please do that. Put your name there, and I'm going to leave it there a couple more weeks. And if you talk to somebody and you know they're needing a prayer partner, please give me their name, and we'll put them in there, and we'll figure out a way to get everybody praying together with each other. So, yeah, just feel free to put your name on there, and we'll get that going in a couple weeks.
Okay, that's it for announcements. I guess we'll have our ushers come ahead. We have ushers here today. Hopefully that wasn't my job because I forgot. All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for bringing us here again today. Thank you for the ability to be here together. Thank you that we can come here and worship you, and thank you for just for the great blessings here, Lord, for the people here, and I just pray for a blessing on this offering as we give here, Lord, that it really might just further your work as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do have some special music if they want to come up.
Everyone is welcome to come and sing with us if they want.
Oh, Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love, in all thy sons command. With glowing hearts we sing thee rise, the true North, strong and free, from far. Stand on guard for thee, God.
Okay, I am going to ask you to stand again with us. What Jesus did for us on the cross, and that's such a wonderful thing to remember when we don't know what the future holds. We do know what the outcome will be, and it's all because of what Christ has done for us.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
I was just doing a little time travel there
a minute ago.
Watching our worship team up here.
And then the Cheddar Girls up here singing.
Reminding us of what a glorious country we live in.
Amen.
Can I hear any amens on that?
We do live in a glorious country.
In spite of troubles we're going through. And I was just thinking, I would love to be able to see where we're going to be at 10 years from now. Wouldn't that be interesting to be able to see? You know, we've got Wes and Devin here. The next church leadership, you know, that could be your board 10 years from now. The Cheddar Girls could be our new worship team 10 years from now. Maybe not even that long. Maybe next week. Who knows? But it's just kind of fascinating how God is raising up another generation, isn't it? It's exciting. To me, it's exciting because all things pass away, and, you know, I'm one of those things that's going to pass away one day and not be here. So we need someone else to be able to step up and be involved. And it's exciting to think about how God does that, how he prepares us for the days ahead. Gord, can I use your joke?
Yes, please.
Can I? Well, I don't see him right now, but Scott's here, I think, somewhere, isn't he?
Yeah.
Did he disappear? Anyway, Gord sent me 10 puns, trying to convince me that puns are beneficial in my sermons, but no pun intended. Come on, you can groan a little more than that. That's pretty bad, right? Scott, who is the king of puns, I think. Anyway, we're going to pray this morning and going to ask God for some things. We're going to praise God for who he is. And Gord's got a prayer request, I believe. Start us off. Okay. Amen. We have a powerful God. And I think we should keep that in mind as we pray to our powerful, all-powerful God. Prayer request this morning, another one. Sandra.
Thank you for the prayers from my cousin Willie. He can still need prayers. He had 4 blockages, so he is out of surgery. He said he's really sore, and he's still in Vancouver. But praying for his salvation, we've been talking a lot about God, actually, and he's seeing, and he's listening, and he's asking for prayer.
Okay, we'll continue to pray for Willie. I'm sure that if he's had those four blockages fixed, he must be feeling somewhat better by now. But that's good. We'll continue to pray for him. Tony.
I guess keep Shad and
Nehemiah. You and me both. Abigail, right? Yeah. Yeah, just a miracle going on there with her, with those implants that she has now. And, you know, let's just pray that she'll be able to hear and learn to speak and just function as a normal hearing child. Just something incredible that she's going through right now. I don't know if you guys are following that or not, but that's Gary and Lynette's great-granddaughter. Had meningitis and it affected her hearing. She became deaf through the meningitis, and now they're through surgery. They're able to hopefully restore her hearing. So that's amazing. Someone else? Dan. Okay. In Iowa?
Ohio.
Cincinnati. Yeah. Okay.
And we should remember all these truck convoys and alleys and stuff that are going on. This nation has come together like I've never seen or heard of before.
Hmm. Hmm.
In among these people that are in the midst of that, in the middle of that, always that people would start to recognize the Creator.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
That's what will turn our country on.
Yeah.
We can rally and rally and rally. We still keep our backs toward Him. We will not win.
Hmm. Amen. Thanks for that, Dan. Yeah, it's amazing what's going on right now. That's for sure. Someone else with a prayer request? Marilyn.
Continue to pray for Mike Stein. I know some of you here have met him. He's been here at the Rolla Church many years ago. He was in a really bad accident over a month ago. He hit his face and came through the windshield and destroyed his face. He's recovering in Edmonton. Learning to swallow and chew again.
Mm. That's amazing. Okay, we'll remember him today. Someone else? David Miller, yeah, we just talked to him this morning. He is probably going to be down in Vancouver for another 10 days or so. Mm. He wants to make sure that he's recovered well enough so that he can function at home on his own before he comes home. So remember David Miller in your prayers, recovering from surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. Wow. God's protection, hey? Yeah. Okay, sure. Oh, go ahead, Kathleen. So many things happen that are even outside of our knowledge and our understanding what God is doing, how he protects us, how he looks out for us, and how he allows things into our lives that are ultimately for our good, even though we may see them as bad. You know, we should just always continually be aware that our Father loves us, and he allows us to go through hard things sometimes for our own good. And let's not forget that. Let's pray together, shall we? God, I thank you this morning again that you are Almighty God. That the evils of this world, the powers of this world do not have power over you. And that you are in control of things. You have a plan, you have a timeline, and you are carrying that out. God, unbeknownst to the world, unbeknownst to most of us, what exactly you're doing in every situation. But God, we can trust you, and we do trust you this morning, and we thank you for who you are. We thank you for how you continually protect us. We've just heard testimony of that this morning, and we don't know how it happened, but you protected Logan in that accident, and we don't know how it happened, but Mike survived that, hitting that moose. And we don't know how it happened, but Willie got help for his heart before it was too late. God, we just thank you for how you're working, and we just recognize your grace in our lives. It's undeserved. We do not deserve the things you give us, and yet you still pour them out, these blessings on our lives. God, there's many people we could pray for, and we've got just a few on our list here this morning that our hearts are overwhelmed. I thank you for what you're doing in Abigail's life, for Shannon, Nehemiah's daughter there, God, losing her hearing through meningitis. And we don't understand that either, God. We know that you could have prevented that, but you allowed it for a reason. And now for her to have these cochlear implants, God, and be able to have hearing as a normal child, the possibility of that, God, is just amazing. Just your grace again poured out on that little child and on their family. So we thank you for that. And we pray, too, we ask you to continue to hold that family close and continue to heal and bring hearing to that little girl. Pray for Gary, God, as he is dear to our hearts, too. Mm-hmm. As he goes in for some more help there in Cincinnati, God, I just pray that you'd give doctors wisdom, help them to find the problem and be able to give help if needed, if necessary. And just pray for your will to be accomplished there. We pray for Gary's heart to be encouraged and for Lynette and for them in their travels. God, just give them safety as well. God, and we continue to pray for Mike and his healing and his whole learning again how to function normally after having his so much damage done to his face. And we just pray that his heart might be encouraged too. We pray for David Miller, God, as he's recovering, and we thank you for his surgery that he was able to have and it's been positive, and I just pray that you'd heal him and allow him to feel your presence this morning as he's missing us and he's missing being home. So I just pray for him that you'd encourage his heart today. Thank you for Logan, too, and we just pray for him that his heart would be encouraged today and help him to know the right time to go back to work, and just pray that you'd continue to heal him and bring him back to full strength and encouragement too. God, I thank you for how you continually direct through your word. You direct in our lives, and I just pray, as Dan has mentioned, for what's happening in our country right now, that it would turn people to you. Like he said, there will be no change unless our eyes are focused on you, and you are the one that can cause change and bring people to a saving knowledge of yourself. You're the one who can bring about godly values and bring about godliness in this country, which we're moving further and further away from. So God, I pray that you would, I don't know what you're going to do through what the events of this week, but God, we just pray that your will would be accomplished, that many would get a sense that they need to turn to you, and that people would be saved through this. God, that they would turn to the gospel of Jesus mm-hmm. Christ. Ultimately, that's the freedom that we all need, to know you as our personal Savior. So we pray, God, as we open your word today, that you direct our hearts, you challenge our hearts, and just encourage us today again. And just lead us, I pray, in Christ's name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, you can open them. I can't tell you where, because we're going to be all over the place. The most challenging part of this job for me is knowing what to preach on every Sunday. And another challenging part of this job is where we're at in today's world. I keep asking the question, God, what do people in our day and age, what do they need to hear? What do you want to say to the people of Rolla this week or next week and the week after? And it's been kind of interesting, because lately it's been a real burden on my heart, because, well, I don't know why, I guess just because of the state of the world is in. But you know what? It always comes back to the same thing. I'll start somewhere, and then suddenly the gospel is there. I'll start in another direction, and suddenly the gospel gets weaved in. And I came to a realization that God wants us to share the gospel. He wants us to tell the world the good news of Jesus Christ. That's now more than ever, that's what the world needs to hear. There's so much talk these days about that we're in the end times, we're in the last days, and that's true. And, you know, I believe that. I believe that we are closer and closer every day. The events that we see happening around us are, it seems to me like they're unprecedented, like it hasn't happened in our lifetime anyway. I can't speak for other generations, but I can speak for what we're going through now, and none of us really have seen the world the way it is right now. And I believe, too, that as we talk about end times and becoming closer to the end times, I believe that the next big thing that's going to happen is the rapture of the church. Now, you might argue with me. I don't know what your eschatology is, whether you're a pre-tribulationalist, a mid-tribulationalist, or a post-trib. And it, to me, let's not make that the thing, because I think this message is relevant no matter what you believe. I particularly hold that view, that of a pre-trib rapture of the church. So in saying that, I say that the next big thing that's going to happen in this world is the Christians are going to disappear. They're going to be taken to heaven. And I believe that it's imminent. And by when I say imminent, I mean there's nothing else that has to happen before this could happen. There's nothing in biblical prophecy that has to be fulfilled before the rapture can take place. And as we think about that, today's message is the influence of the rapture. I want us to think about, as you think about the rapture, how does that influence you day to day? How does that make a difference in your life when you get up in the morning, when you go to work in the morning, when you take your kids to school, when you, whatever it is you do, what difference does it make knowing that the rapture is imminent? Because I believe that the rapture should have an impact on our life. I really do believe that. The rapture has an influence, and my first point is a converting influence on seeking hearts. When I'm talking about seeking hearts, I'm talking about the unsaved world, the people that are looking for something. They're looking for something. They're seeking something that they haven't found yet, and the rapture has an influence on seeking hearts. We're all somewhat aware of our mortality. We have no guarantees how long we're going to live. There's two things we should be very aware of. First one is the rapture is imminent. Could happen at any moment. You believe that?
Yes.
Okay. Second thing is we have no idea when our appointment with God is. None of us. Whether you're 5 years old or whether you're 85 years old, or somewhere in between, none of us know when our appointment with God is, but we do know that we have one, right? Those two things should affect us on a daily basis. We're aware of our mortality. We've seen our grandparents, some of us. We've seen our parents, some of us, have passed away and gone to be with the Lord. And it makes us aware that, yeah, there's an end coming. Life isn't going to go on forever. You know, when you're young, sometimes you think that, oh, I got my whole life ahead of me. It's going to just be great. It's going to go on for, you know, I can't even imagine how long it's going to last. It's going to go on for a long time. But one thing we know about life, what is that one thing?
Die.
We don't come out alive, do we? No. The odd exception, you know, Enoch perhaps could testify a difference. But in biblical prophecy, what we're told is that Christ could come at any moment to get his bride. And what that means for everyone else is they will be left behind. They will be left behind to endure the tribulation that's what the Bible calls the terrible day of the Lord. So, where I'm going with this is we need to ask the question, am I ready? Am I there? Am I ready for Christ to come today? Or am I ready if he decides to take me home today via accident or mishap of some sort? Because we know that could happen. Am I ready? That's the question we should be asking our own hearts. And we know from Scripture, too, that salvation is only available through Jesus Christ. We sang those songs. I mean, Angela talked about the theme from the music today. Well, it's all about what Christ has done for us. It's all about our salvation, isn't it? Just marvelous, wonderful songs that sing about his amazing love for us and how he came and how he took care of our sin debt for us. You know, it's interesting when you share the gospel with somebody, you always got to share the bad news before you can share the good news. People have to understand the bad news, otherwise the good news doesn't really make sense. The good news isn't really seen as applicable if you don't understand the bad news. In Isaiah 59 and verse 2, it says, "But your iniquities," or your sins, "have separated you from God. And your sins have hidden his face from you, so he will not hear." That's the bad news. That's the bad news. Our sins have separated us from God. That's how we were born. That's how we will be until we come to know him. Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." It's a short little verse with huge impact. Huge impact. For all have sinned. Everybody in this room, everybody in this community, everybody in this province, everybody in this country, everybody in this world has sinned and falls short of God's glory. That's the bad news. That's the bad news. Without some intervention, without some outside help, we are doomed. We are lost. We cannot meet God's perfect standard. We're doomed. And the trouble is there's nothing we can do to pay for our sin. There's nothing we can do to, you know, we can have lots of money and we can give it to the church. We cannot buy our way into heaven. We will fall short. Our account will run out before we have paid our way into heaven. We can work like beavers. We can climb the ladder of success. And guess what? That ladder does not reach to heaven. It falls short. We can join the church that you have to be in if you want to be in heaven. And you'll find out that church doesn't reach heaven. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Isaiah 64:6 says, but we are all like an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses, these things I've just been describing, are like filthy rags. And I know what I do with my filthy rags. I throw them out. I get rid of them. I burn them. They're no good. A clean rag, now that's different. I can use a clean rag, but a filthy rag. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. That's the bad news. But there is good news. And we sang about that this morning. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he came to satisfy that sin debt. He came to take our place. He took our punishment on the cross. He went to the cross. He died in our place. Because of sin, we have to die, God said. The day you eat of it, Eve and Adam, you will surely die, is what God said. And that has been happening ever since, that original sin. But Jesus came and he died and he hung on a cross like this. The one we have up here is a symbol. He hung there and he died for you and me. He went into the grave and 3 days later, God raised him from the dead. God raised him from the dead to prove one thing. That he was completely satisfied with Jesus' payment for sin. He was completely satisfied. I was going to have this piece of paper, this certificate, which I believe would have been appropriate, that says, Bob Rempel, guilty of sin, needs to die for his sin. I didn't get that done, but you have to use your imagination a little bit. 1 Peter 3:15, he says, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which is contrary to us, he has taken it out of the way and nailed it to the cross. It's as though that he took that certificate that had my name on it and said guilty of sin, and he wrote pardoned on there, and he nailed it to the cross. And that's how that pardon came about. That's what he's saying here in 1 Peter 3:15. Sorry, Colossians 2:14. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements against us. Isn't that amazing? You know, some of you might have ended up in court sometime and been found guilty of something. I don't know. But to have somebody come along and say, I'm taking care of that for you. I'm paying your fine. I'm paying your penalty for you. And the judge can write on your handwriting of guilt there, pardoned, set free. That's the freedom we need, people. We're fighting for all kinds of freedoms in Canada right now, but the real freedom comes when we are set free from sin and given eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's the good news. 1 Peter 3:18 says this, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God and being put to death in the flesh, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. One time, he died. The just for the unjust. He was just, we're unjust. He did it for us. And he offers that salvation to us as a free gift. We accept it. How? We accept it by believing in him, by believing in his death on our behalf. We accept it by acknowledging our sin, recognizing the bad news in our life, recognizing that we need his salvation. Without it, we are lost. We're doomed. So we have to ask, have you made that decision? I don't know everybody here completely, and I don't know your hearts for sure. If you've not made that decision, you can do that right now. We can stop the service right now, and you can get saved right now. And I implore you, do not wait. Do not walk out of these doors today without having that settled in your heart. Don't wait another day. You're gambling. You're gambling with your eternal soul. Knowing that the rapture could happen at any moment makes this decision so much more urgent. You might think, well, I got a long time to live, but you don't know when Christ is coming back. And trust me, you don't want to live through the tribulation. Read Revelation. Read the book of Revelation and ask yourself, do I want to live through that? You can accept that free gift right now. You know, there was another guy in the Bible who was desperate. And he cried out, it was Paul's jailer in Philippi. He says, what must I do to be saved? And Paul said to him, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus. Jesus hasn't made it difficult. He has made it very simple. Simple that a child can understand these things. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Don't take a chance on your destiny. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved today. The rapture should influence those seeking hearts to seek him out. Second point here, the rapture has an influence, a caring influence on soul-winning hearts. And it's kind of related to the first one, but now I'm talking to you who know Christ. I'm talking to you who have a window into the future. If you've read any of Revelation, you can't help but be overwhelmed by the power and by the wrath of God that you see in Revelation, in the book of Revelation. What the world faces after the rapture will be like, unlike anything that has ever happened on earth before. We may think that we've lived through some hard things. Much of the world has lived through some hard things like floods and earthquakes and volcanoes and fires and just to name a few. But the rapture, not the rapture, the tribulation is going to be so much worse. So much worse. The Bible tells us that if God doesn't intervene, the entire population of the world would have been wiped out. But God had shortened, how does it go? What's the verse? Kind of went blank there. If God hadn't stepped in, the whole earth would have been wiped out during that time. The Bible also describes what it'll be like for those who die without Christ. They face eternal horrors and eternal separation from God. And I don't even want to think about what that would be like. I can't imagine it. You can't imagine it. And we don't want to be there. We don't want to be one of those people that faces eternal separation from God. Mm-hmm. When we read Revelation and when we think about the rapture, we think about the biblical prophecy we're talking about, it brings us face to face with what's truly at stake. What's truly at stake for those who don't know Christ. You know, I'm secure in my salvation. I believe that I'm safe in God's hand. Amen? Mm-hmm. But my heart goes out to those who don't have that. And the rapture has an influence on a heart that's a soul-winning heart, and it should have an influence on your heart as you think about those people that you know who have rejected Christ in their life. 2 Corinthians reminds us of our calling as believers. What are we to do? You know, it's like I was telling you earlier, what am I supposed to be preaching on Sunday after Sunday? Well, he keeps nudging me back towards the gospel. Why is that? Because that's what we need to hear. That's what other people need to hear. That's what we need to share. 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." Guess what? They're pulling the ambassadors out of the Ukraine right now. Why is that? Because there's impending doom, right? Because there could be a war there. The ambassadors from Canada, the United States, and these different countries are being asked to come home. You're an ambassador for Christ. You haven't been asked to come home yet, have you? You haven't been pulled back to be in the safe place yet. We're still in the war zone. We are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. That's why we're here, people. That's why we're here at this time, for such a time as this. That is why God has left the church here. So that we can be that light, we can be that message to people who need to hear it. As believers, we have an insider's view. Talk about inside trading, right? Having knowledge about something that nobody else has. As believers, we have that. We have a window into the future. Unsaved people don't have that window into the future. They're floundering. We have a window into the future that the rest of the unbelieving world cannot see. And God has us here as his ambassadors. And what do ambassadors do? They represent. We represent God to the world. We represent God and his heart for the lost. And if God has a heart for the lost, then that should be our heart too. God's word says he's not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. We know that not everyone will come to repentance. We can see that from his word too. But we don't know who they are. So we need to speak when given the opportunity. We need to be bold in sharing sharing our faith with others as God brings them into our lives. We have a hope that the world doesn't have. You know what? Much of the world is hopeless. They don't see any future. All they see is death and destruction and violence and hate, racism. And they're trying to deal with it the best they can, but they don't have the tools. They come short. They come short of the glory of God. So it should affect us. 1 Peter 3:15, Peter says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense for anyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." Do people see hope in your life? Do they see something different in you? Do they see that you're not throwing up your hands and saying, "Oh, what's ever going to happen in this world? Doom and gloom." Or is that what you're portraying? We should have a hope in us that the world sees and they said, "Where do you get that? Where do you get that hope? How can you be so positive in today's world?" Well, because we know where we're going, right? We know we have an answer for them. Always be ready to give a defense. Be willing to share this hope that you have. Should be one of our daily prayers that we would look for opportunities and we would ask God for opportunities and we would ask God for the boldness to speak in those opportunities, because sometimes we're shy and sometimes we're afraid of how people might respond. But listen, we're talking to people who have no hope. They have no future. They're facing eternal death. They're facing an eternity without God. certainly we can be bold to share the good news with them. What other influence does the rapture have on us? I believe it has a cleansing influence on hearts that are sinful. If the rapture is imminent, meaning it could happen at any moment, then Christians should live in the light of the rapture. Now I'm going to explain what I mean by that. We should live in the light of the rapture. 1 John 3, verses 2 and 3. Beloved, now we are children of God. And that would describe us. And it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. We don't know what our glorified self is going to look like. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. We know that somewhat what our glorified self is going to be like. We're going to be like Christ. For we shall see him as he is. We will physically be able to see him. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. So by living in the light of the gospel, or in the light of the rapture, if we have a proper understanding of the rapture, then it should produce in us a life of holiness and purity. If we have focused both our heart and our mind on the coming of Christ, this can be a powerful motivator for us to live a life free of sin and stay away from impure living. It's a perfect prescription for living a holy life. How can someone who is focused on the second coming of Christ, who is focused on their eternal destiny and the eternal future that they have with him, how can that person then turn around and live in sin? Well, verse 3 says you can't do it. You can't do both those things. Everyone who has this hope, what hope is he talking about? He's talking about the rapture. He's talking about going to be with Christ. He's talking about eternity in heaven. Anyone who has this hope in him purifies himself. Just as Christ is pure. Just as God is pure.
And since we don't know the exact day Christ is coming, we need to be ready all the time. We need to always be ready. Living pure and holy all the time. You can't just say, well, you know what? There's no panic. I can live how I want right now, and I'll be ready when the time comes. We don't know when the time comes.
There's another verse here from Titus 2. 12 and 13, it says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present age. Then he ties it to the rapture. He says, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see how the relationship between the rapture and holy living? It's brought out in several verses here. I probably told you this story before, but one time when my brother and I were younger, well, I guess that was any time before today, but quite a while ago, okay? We were teenagers. My parents decided to go on a holiday without us. They only ever did this one time, and I always wondered about that, but they decided to go to Saskatchewan and leave the boys at home, and they gave us this long list of jobs that we had to accomplish while we were home, and they were gone like, I don't know, a couple weeks or whatever. So we got into all kinds of trouble. But we didn't touch that list. That list laid there, and we never looked at it. Until a few days before they were going to come home, then conscience started to get the best of us. And we started looking at the list and say, oh, we better get at it, you know. So we scrambled around, and we tried to do as much as we could on the list. But the difference there is we knew when they were coming back. We knew exactly the day they were going to arrive, or close to it. We didn't have cell phones or even telephones in those days. So we kind of figured they were going to be back on a certain day, so we knew what we had to be ready for. You know, that's the difference between my parents coming back and Christ coming back. We don't know when he's coming. We got away with it. We can't do that in our Christian life. We can't clean up our act in the last minute like these two delinquent Rempel boys. We must be ready all the time. Be ready all the time. It's kind of like, you know, you go to the airport, you check in, you're sitting there, you're waiting for your flight, and they come on the intercom and they say, your flight has been delayed. So what do? You grab your bags and you go downtown and you start shopping, right? No, you don't do that. You stay there and you wait because you do not know when they're going to call that flight. You don't know how long the delay is. So you're there. You're ready. You don't want to miss it. Well, this is a flight you don't want to miss either, is it? Romans 13. Got lots of verses here for you this morning. And do this knowing the time. He says knowing the time. Well, we don't. I just said we don't know the time. Generally speaking, we know the time, don't we? Mm-hmm. We know where we're at. We know we're in the last days. And I described this to you once before. I believe that every church in every generation from the very first century thought they were in the last days. Why does Paul write these last days, these perilous times, these last days? Why does Peter write about it? Why does John write about it? They all wrote about it. They all saw themselves as living in the last days because they also knew that everything that the Bible said had to happen before Christ's second coming had happened. What had to happen? Well, the Savior had to come. The Savior had to be born. The Savior had to live his life and have a ministry. He had to die on a cross. He had to rise again. He had to go back to heaven. All those things had happened. There was nothing. They didn't know whether Christ was going to go back to heaven and come back the next day, or whether it was going to be 2022 years before he came back. But it's as though history was moving forward in a direction, and they came right to the brink of the end of the world, and then history started to move sideways. So at any time, we could step off. You see what I'm saying? I think that's a great illustration of where we're at today. All of those writers of the New Testament thought they were in the last days and Christ could come back at any moment. And you know what? God wants us to live that way. He wants us to have that hope in us that Christ could come tomorrow. Christ could come today. So when he talks about knowing the time here in this verse, that was a long explanation, about three words, but that's what he means. And do this, knowing the time that you are in the last days, that now it's high time to wake up out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. That's a challenge to us. Get serious. Wake up. Don't dabble around in sin. Don't live your life in sin thinking that somehow or another you're gonna have time to clean up your act before he comes. We see the signs. I was thinking about a time when we were stuck on the river in Papua New Guinea, me and my son and a couple other guys. It got dark, and it gets very dark in New Guinea when there's no moon. It gets very dark everywhere where there's no moon, but it seemed like it was really dark there. We were stuck on this river, and we had tubes, and we'd been tubing down this river, and we were stuck there, and we were on this little tiny sandbar, and it was raining, and we had no dry clothes, and we knew it was going to be a long night. It's going to be cold. It's not really cold in Papua New Guinea, but when you have wet clothes and you have nothing to keep you warm, it gets cold. We were there all night in the darkness. We knew we could not move in the darkness safely. We waited, and then you know what? The first hint of light, 5:30 in the morning, whatever it was, we said, we're getting out of here. The night is far spent. It's time to move. And that's really what he's saying here in Romans 13. The night is far spent. Salvation is right here. The second coming is right here. We need to wake up and start living our lives in light of that. Be urgent about the gospel. Don't be dabbling in sin. Second Peter 3, 10 to 14. Oh, I didn't finish that other passage. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. He says that's living in the light of where we're at today, knowing the night is far spent. This is how we should be behaving and living out our lives. Now we'll go to 2 Peter 3, verses 10 and on. And he describes what we're talking about. He describes what's going to happen in the end. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise and the elements will melt with fervent heat, and both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Kind of makes us think about what are these things we're building here on earth? They're just going to be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God? Hastening means to eagerly look forward to. Because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt away with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look to the new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, be looking forward to these things. Be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless. That's a long passage, but there's so much in there. I would encourage you to go home and just meditate on that for a while. Meditate on that. Live in the light of that. Live in the light of the truth of the gospel. The truth of the rapture is just around the corner. Looking forward, and he says, be eager. Be eager for this. Don't be walking around saying, well, I sure hope Christ doesn't come back today because I wanted to go race my motorbike today. Come on. Oh, I hope Christ doesn't come back today because I've got wedding plans. Oh, I hope Christ doesn't come back. Whatever you put in there, it's just lame compared to what it's going to be like when Christ comes back, right? You know, it's like saying, I hope Christ comes back today because... No, that's not what I was going to say. It's like wanting to eat peanut butter and jelly when you've got a beautiful steak waiting for you. I don't know. I'm going off track here now. You can see how knowing these prophecies about the rapture and what's following it, it should have this cleansing effect on our lives. It should be motivating us to want to live godly so that we won't be ashamed at his coming. He won't be ashamed of us. We won't be ashamed of ourselves. It should motivate us to have a desire to walk in his spirit and not in the flesh. And it should cause us to sense the urgency and be ready at every moment. I have one more point here. The rapture has a calming influence on stirring hearts. And when I say stirring hearts, I mean troubled hearts. These are definitely troubling days, I would have to admit. There's so much sin in the world, so much evil going on, so much corruption, so much violence, so much ungodliness. It's very hard not to be troubled by it all. And many of us are just sick of it. I think I've talked to enough of you to where you feel the same way I do. It's hard not to be troubled by it. And this word troubled means stirred up, disturbed, unsettled, confused. Those are words that would describe our attitudes. I was saying to Karen this morning on the way to church, it's amazing how quickly one can go from being completely encouraged to completely discouraged. It's like he can flip a switch and one day be totally discouraged. But when we focus on the rapture, when we focus on what's in store for us, we don't have to be troubled. We don't have to be discouraged. The rapture should have that practical effect on us that brings a calmness in troubling times. Disciples were troubled. Jesus had told them, he says, by the way, they're going to kill me. And I'm not going to be with you anymore. You think that didn't trouble the disciples? Yeah. He was the Savior. He's the promised one. He's the Messiah. And he's telling them that he's going to die? It troubled them. Jesus had words for them. He says, let not your heart be troubled, John 14. You believe in God, believe also in me. By the way, I am God. I think I told you that already, guys. In my Father's house are many mansions. If were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go out and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He gave them great words to calm their hearts. You know, the world has always had trouble. Trouble is the common denominator of mankind. You guys remember math class? Teacher would give you a bunch of numbers up on the blackboard, and she'd say, or he'd say, find the common denominator. Do you remember what that was? That was that number that would equally divide into those numbers that were already there. You could take that and you could divide it equally, right? It was the common denominator, the thing that those numbers had in common. Well, trouble is the common denominator of mankind. Job said this. He said, yet man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. Have you ever been around a campfire and seen the sparks go down? No, they go upward. They go upward. Job said, it's as natural as that. The world is full of trouble. And Job was one who knew about trouble. He is trouble's poster boy. There are many things that get us down. Illness, tragedy, injury, economic uncertainty, relationship struggles, and the list goes on and on. We have tons of things that can discourage us and cause us to be troubled. But one of the great comforts for us is when we are discouraged by these things is to remember the Lord's coming back. The Lord's coming back. Could be today. And then all those things that I'm worried about, they're gone. They will be gone. I can't take one of those with me. I can't take any of my worries with me. Think about that. Think about all the things that are stressing you right now. Whether it's your health, whether it's your economic situation, whether it's just getting out of bed in the morning because of your health or whatever. All those things are going to be gone. He says three things here. He mentions three different things in this passage that should be an encouragement to us to help our hearts to be calm. He says, first of all, he mentions a person. He says, you believe in God, believe also in me. He talks about himself. As we think about Jesus Christ, it should calm our hearts. He's coming back for us. Secondly, he talks about a place. He talks about the New Jerusalem. He talks about this place that he's gone to prepare for us. I was listening to one of those many Facebook postings that talked about that convoy that went to Ottawa yesterday. They said it was 1,500 miles long. You know the first thing that came to my mind? That's the size of New Jerusalem. It's 1,500 miles square. Think of it. That's where I'm going to live. Why am I discouraged? What have I got to worry about? Nothing. I don't know why the Lord brings these crazy things to my mind sometimes, but When they said it's 1,500 miles long, I thought, that's exactly the size of New Jerusalem. 1,500 miles long, 1,500 miles wide, 1,500 miles high. It's a cube. According to the commentators who do all that math in there. So as we come closer day by day to the second coming, it should influence us in these ways. First of all, we need to be ready. We need to be ready, and I'll say it again. I'm not ashamed to say it. You need Jesus Christ in your life. If he's not there, if he's not what you are trusting in for your salvation, then you're not on the train. I'm sorry, you're not. You won't be going with us. Secondly, that we are ready to share the hope that we have, that it should be the forefront up here, not back here somewhere where you have to think about, well, what would I say to somebody if they asked me why you were so positive? It should be right here. It should be in the front of your mind. I always talked about the language we learned in Papua New Guinea. It somehow went from here back to here when we came back to Canada. It's hard to find. But the gospel message that we have should be right on the tip of our tongue all the time, ready to share it with those who have no hope. Thirdly, that we're living holy and godly lives in preparation for his coming. So there will be no shame, there will be no embarrassment when Christ shows up, because we'll be living for him. And lastly, that we don't let these troubling times get us down, that we don't let discouragement seep in, because all that means is we're focused on the wrong things. Focus on the second coming. Focus on the rapture. Focus on your eternal life in heaven, and you won't be discouraged. I'm going to stop there. We're going to talk some more about this in Sunday school, so if you can stick around for that, great. In the meantime, we're going to pray, and then we'll let the kids go downstairs, and you guys can grab a coffee, and we'll come back for Sunday school. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for the insider's view that you've given us into what's going to happen next. And God, we don't know precisely the moment or the day, but we know it's going to happen, and we're excited about it. We look forward to it eagerly, recognizing that all the pain and suffering will be wiped away. We'll be with you forever in heaven. And while that's an exciting thought, it's also a sobering thought for those that don't know you yet. So we just pray that, God, that you just give us a heart to share what we know with those around us. I thank you, God, for who you are and for this message of the rapture and how it should influence us and affect us. Go with us today and encourage us as we continue on here. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You guys have another song? Okay.
You'll stand with us. I'm hoping this song isn't brand new for all of you, but either way, it's one that's meant a lot to me lately.
To heaven and spoke your name.
Jesus Christ.